Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father, we have come to thy table to feast on your most holy word. Lord, we know that we need it for our spiritual nourishment. Lord, your text, O Lord, the scripture we read would seem to be like a plain text, but O Lord, speak to us so that, O Lord, we would understand your mind. O Lord, teach us to love you with all our mind so that we would understand, O Lord, your word. And Lord, Holy Spirit, therefore, renew our mind, O Lord, with your wisdom. Refresh our spirit with your peace and revive our heart with faith. Holy Spirit, cleanse our heart and our lips so that we would read your most holy word. Open our mind, O Lord, so that we would understand the hidden and the wonderful truths in your law. Lord, give us knowledge and understanding of all kinds of literature and learning. Holy Spirit, rest upon us. Holy Spirit, guide us. Holy Spirit, possess us. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, we read about this particular passage, and we might have read it many a times, about Jesus performing miracle in the synagogue. Now, this particular passage that we read today, it starts from where Jesus is performing a miracle in the synagogue, where a man with shriveled hand is being healed on the day of Sabbath. And there is confrontation between Jesus and the scribes and the Pharisees that Jesus performed miracle on the day of Sabbath. And then he moves on to Galilee. Now, Galilee is his hometown. And let me just brief you about Galilee. Galilee is divided into two, the Upper Galilee and the Lower Galilee. I think I might have shared this, but still, it is just a little bit of a recap that I wanted to do. The Upper Galilee is consisted of the elite, the Pharisees, the people who are loyal, the Jews who are loyal to the Roman government, and the people who are the rich and the famous are staying in the Upper Galilee. But the Lower Galilee consists of the peasants, the poor, the lame, the lepers, the carpenters, the fishermen. These are the people who stay in the lower part of Galilee. Now here we understand when Jesus is coming all the way from Galilee, all the way to Galilee, the people heard about him performing a miracle in the synagogue, and this is the time when all the people, now look at the people who all came from which places, Sidon, Tyre, Idumea, the borders of Jordan, and even Jerusalem. Now remember, Jerusalem is called the city of peace. Jeru means city, Salem means peace. And God promised his presence in Jerusalem. And if people from Jerusalem has to come, imagine those people were also inflicted, which means that even God's people are afflicted. They are also afflicted. They were also being sick, and they are also being healed. But look at that. Now Jesus, who performed miracle in the synagogue, had power even to perform miracle in the world as well. That means outside the synagogue. That means Jesus is called the Word of God, and the Word of God has power not only inside the church or the synagogue, but even outside. And Jesus performed more miracles, you see, outside the synagogue, which means the Word of God has power. I wanted to share 3 points in today's message. The first point is emptiness. That is, we are inflicted by emptiness. Now, if you look at the people who came to Jesus, they looked like normal people, but they were crushed from within. They used to go. Now, these are the people. Now, if you talk about the people who stayed at Jerusalem, they are the people who went to the synagogue. They praised, they worshipped, they prayed, they even followed the law to its letter. Well, this is how, you know, generally we are. And the people who were afflicted, they all went to that place. That is quite understandable, but still did not find deliverance till the time Christ came in their lives. They did not find deliverance till then. See, I happened to have a blister in my mouth, and it was very hard for me to have food. Because I'm used to having the spicy food, I need a lot of spice. It should burn my tongue. I have that kind of a hot and spicy food. But that day when I had the blister in my mouth, I couldn't have food properly. And my face was downcast. And my wife was saying, you look so downcast and pale. I said, I'm not able to eat properly. Just a blister can make so much, and it can affect your body so much. Just imagine how the people who were afflicted and who knew that Jesus could heal them, the Word, Jesus is the Word, could heal them, and they came to Jesus. This is how, you know, we tend to be, because we, when we are afflicted, we do not know where exactly are we heading to. It's we find several directions. Now, say for example, there was one such person who had problems with his health, and one of the church member advised, no, why don't you do yoga? Now remember, yoga is a cult. We shouldn't practice it. Do not do that, because that is inviting the kind of, if you're you are imitating the gods of that, and you are welcoming those gods. See, initially yoga might sound to be very good and well, meaning it would give you some kind, but in a long run, it is going to affect you very badly. It is a cult, do not follow. And this is what, you know, we tend to seek direction from people. The second point which I wanted to share is about, now before I, you know, share the second point, let me just share about, you know, the people who were afflicted. Now they looked like normal people. They looked like normal people. And they came with that intention that Christ would heal. See, this is what happened with me. Well, I was going through a kind of depression in my life. Every time I used to go to church, I used to, see, I have been with quite a few churches, okay. When I was at St. Paul's Kola, I, because of some controversy of the priest with church members, I left the church and I started going to another church. I started going to St. Mary's for the English service. This was way back in 1996. And that's the time, you know, when I was just trying to find peace. So I started going to that church. And I stayed there for just 6 months. Again, I moved from there and I started going to Santa Cruz Mar Thoma Church in the morning. They had morning service every Sundays. So I started going there. I also used to go to Mahim Church, that is St. Michael's, where it is a Catholic church. I used to offer garlands at the feet of Jesus, just to find peace, because I knew that I was afflicted. See, I used to take part in everything. I used to take part in Bible reading, praise and worship. See, then somebody told me, no, why don't you go to one organization? That's the time when the Bombay Baptist Church was growing. And I got in contact with one of the group and I started going there. Again, I was feeling empty. I was taking part in the praise and worship. I was taking part in prayer. I started to pray. I learned to pray over there. Then somebody introduced me. Then I was not finding comfortable when they said, you take baptism and left the church. Then I moved on from there to Alliance Church. And over there, I started going, I attended the worship. But again, that was just a handful of people. I was not comfortable. I left that church as well. So I was with Alliance Church for another 2 years. Then from there, I moved on to New Life. I went to Pentecostal Church. I went even to a church called Church at Pawai. And everywhere I went, I just used to think, you know, that somebody would get a divine revelation and just lay hands on my head and say, this is your problem and God is telling me to pray for you. This is what I thought, that somebody would pray. Now remember, dear church, I used to run from pillar to post. I used to attend crusades, say Brother Dinakaran crusade or probably Benny Hinn crusade or whatever crusade, I used to be part of it. But still my life was empty, because I did not turn to the Word of God. My dear church, listen carefully. Word speaks to you. It speaks to you, and that's where, when I started to listen to the Word of God, that's where I started to understand what is the meaning of the what power it has in my life. what power it has in my life. See, we just follow what, you know, just we make it a point to go to church, we make it a point to read. Well, you do such things. These are channels of grace. It's not that you don't do it. You give offerings to the church, it's a good thing you do. But if you stay away from the word of God, your life will always be empty, and that is what I had gone through in my life. My life was empty. I was so empty in my life that I couldn't find any peace despite going to so many churches, despite going to any church. I always felt, okay, now at least I would find peace, but I never found peace. Till the time I turned to the word of God. The second point which I wanted to share is, you are designed for victory. You are designed for victory. Psalm 23. You know, when we read about Psalm 23, we read about the dark valley situation. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Now, it comes after the passage. And you read. Now, if you read Psalm 23, I'll just read out for you. It says that, when you walk, see, before you pass through the valley of the shadow of death, there is a verse which is a strong defense in our lives. You know, it says, he restores my soul. He guides me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. And then all of a sudden there comes, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. See, when we are going through a time where there is peace and we think everything is gone, that's where the dark valley situation has come into our life. What is the dark valley situation? A no hope situation. A situation where we feel, Lord, let me die. I'm fed up with this life. I think I shared this, but still I'm sharing. It's the kind of a life that we are going through. My life changed when I started to read the word of God. And I realized that my God is all-knowing. He knew that I would be afflicted. He knew that I would be going through depression. I had so many questions. I'm telling you, I was running from church to church asking questions. But finally, when I started to read the word of God, that's where God gave me an answer. So it is like this, a father advising the child what to do. My father used to tell me, my son, listen very carefully. Don't give money to anybody. Don't drink. Even though I am a social drinker, but you don't drink. Even though I smoke, you don't smoke. These are the advice which my father gave. I followed that advice. And what happened? I found success. I found success. See, my dear church, this is how the word of God is. When you sit with the Lord and when God speaks to you, see, I often tell that even now I would like to say that, you know, when you're reading a verse particular, take about 4 or 5 verses, take the one that has touched you or that has appealed you and ask God to give you a message out of it. Last week, what happened was I was meditating on James chapter 1:19. It says that everybody should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. And God gave me a message immediately saying that those who are angry, they tend to speak a lot, and that's the time you need to remain quiet. But God adds something more to it. I faced a situation that gave me the answer for this verse. And that's where I'm doing my PhD and we have Zoom classes. So that's the time when the faculty asked me a question. Elvin, if you were angry when you were young, and how did your mother respond? So I gave a very vague answer. I said, my mother used to say, you be more angry. But then later on, I realized, and I tried to rehearse, I shouldn't have said this. Instead, I should have said this way. See, that is what, you know, when you are meditating on the word, that situation speaks to you. That very situation speaks to you. See, you may have a lot of issues in your life. You may have a lot of issues in your life, but whenever you go out from your home, take a verse on your mind rather than thinking as what's going to happen. Take a verse on your mind, meditate on it. Keep walking, asking Lord, what is the message? And God will show you a situation, and through the situation, God will speak to you. Well, this is what God spoke to me. He spoke through my situation. And that's where God told me about this particular verse of James chapter 1:19. He said, Elvin, make sure that next time if you don't have an answer, politely say, I don't have an answer. Well, it's better to give a wise answer than giving a foolish answer and then later on regretting. Second important thing that God spoke to me is this. Just pause for a while and say, Holy Spirit, lead me in giving the right answer. See, these are things which you learn when you start to see. You give importance to the word of God. That's when you realize what you have to say. He will teach you. He will. The third important point which I wanted to share is that you are designated to be a victor. Third point, you are designated to be a victor. Psalm 144:1 says that He trains our hands for war, our fingers for battle. I repeat, it says, the psalmist says that He trains our hands for war and our fingers for battle, which means in our life journey, there will be battles. Second, most important thing which you need to understand is this. God will first fight the battles for you. Second, He will fight with you. Third, He will see you fighting, but see that you're safe. But in all battles, you will be victor. That is the promise. I repeat, the first battle, when you start your journey with the Lord, the initial battle will be fought by God. Then comes a time when God will battle with you. The battle with you. And third is the time when He will watch you battle and He will give you the strength to fight. That's where God wants you to be. See, you look at the life of the Israelites. When Joseph brought them to Egypt, they were shepherds. And then they ended up as slaves. But when God took them out of Egypt, they became warriors. They started to battle with giants. Dear church, that is where God wants us to be a victory. See, generally what happens is in our lives, you know, see, in my case as well, when I am desperately in need of something and I pray for it, I never get it. So I complained. I used to say, Lord, I asked for 10 things and you give only one. And I have to beg to such a point that finally you give me just peanuts in my hand. But you look at others, they don't go to church, and once in a while when they want something to be prayed on, when their needs are there, they go to the church and their prayers are immediately answered. But my prayers are never answered. Well, this is the kind of a prayer I used to pray. I used to argue with the Lord. See, generally what happens is, dear church, when we are inflicted with pain, say for example, if I have a pain on my left hip or my abdomen, we try to adjust and put more pain, we adjust ourselves to the right. So what we do is, we try to adjust with the pain. But we are so, we don't try to, you know, get rid of the pain. Rather than we try to adjust with the pain. That's the kind of a life that we live. I wanted to share a story about a man who was the lone survivor of the shipwreck. So what happened was that when his ship was almost sunk, that's the time he was near to a very close island that was uninhabited, and he was the lone survivor. So what he did was whatever he had, his clothes and everything, he tried and stored it in that place, and he made a hut, and in that hut he stored everything. So he had food for a few days. So he thought probably any ship that would pass by, probably, you know, he could just find a rescue and they might pick him up. But as the days went by, when he fell short of food, he went in search of food. And when he went in search of food, to his tragedy, when he came back, the unimaginable happened. The hut was inflamed. And he started to complain, Lord, what have you done? This is what I had. And now you have taken that as well. But you won't believe, that became a smoke signal, and by which the nearby ship came and rescued him. Yeah. We are also in some same kind of a situation where we complain when we go through such kind of a situation. But remember, every storm has a lesson. We learn something out of it. Every storm makes us strong. Don't say, Lord, take away my problems, but pray this prayer from today. Lord, build me up. Build me up for the next event or the next storm that is in store for me, so that I can face it and I can understand your power. Look at the life of Paul. When he was imprisoned, he did not cry. He did not complain. Rather, what did he do? He started to write letters. That became the part of God's word. This is what we should do. Maintain a diary every day. Lord, I had gone through these struggles, but I believe I may not be able to understand you, but teach me to trust you. This should be our prayer. Look at the life of David, dear church. Look at the life of David. He was being chased by Saul, and he found a place in cave where he wrote all the poems and the psalm which we read. He was in the wilderness. That's where he composed songs. Well, that kind of a life which God expects from us, to see how much we can trust him. It's easy to complain. See, when we go through problems, we can sit and cry. Oh Lord, why did you do such things? And we keep sitting and we sit and we cry. But that's not going to serve our purpose. What God is saying is, Elvin, even if you cry, you come, walk with me. Walk with me. I will show you the things that you need to do. And that's where we find the resources. And that's where God leads us to the right resources. Get up and walk to your church. In crying, it's not going to serve a purpose. The Bible clearly says, you're still infants. Be mature. Grow up. Don't feed on milk. Feed on solid food. That's what the book of Hebrews says. Chapter 5:12 says, feed on food, solid food. Be matured as a man. How long will you continue to feed on milk? Churches, this is what, we when we go through struggles in life, we just look, we are very nearsighted in our lives. We do not know what exactly to be done. And we land up into confusion. We land up into worries. The more you worries, the more you think, the more you will be worried, I'm telling you. The more you give time to meditate on the word of God, God speaks through that word. My face was dark with worries. I'm telling you, my face was dark with worries, but now my face is, already I'm dark, but still, my face is more radiant now. I'm so glad God has worked in my life. Well, it's not on the face I'm saying, but my heart is more joyful today. Today, I may have everything. I may not have kids, but I don't care about it. I know my Lord has some bigger plan for me. Some bigger plan, and I have to focus. Till then, I was just thinking that, I'm telling you, we don't have children. So I was just thinking, Lord, we have children. But then when I started to read the word of God, I understood, Elvin, I have chosen you for some bigger plan. Don't focus on these things. There would be a time I may not have children. Well, it doesn't care now. I used to. That's what God makes you, overcomers of every situation. Well, I want to share just one small story and then I'll end up this message. It's about the agarwood. Well, agarwood is a kind of a wood that comes from the tree that is called Aguilaria tree. And it is a tree that produces this agarwood. Now, this agarwood is a wood that is basically, it produces incense. And it is very costly because 1 kilo of agar wood costs about $100 million. So if this agar wood, now if the tree, the Aguilaria tree, if it is not inflected with mold, it cannot produce this agar wood. It has to be inflected first. Otherwise, it is just an ordinary wood. So what happens is through the forces of nature, or probably animals coming and scratching its bark and inflicting a kind of a wound on it, that's where it is inflected with mold. And that fungal infection makes it fragrant. Now, this Aguilaria tree's defense is to, the way that this incense is worked is this way. A stress-induced aromatic essence is produced out of this this tree. Get rid of this. It's as a defense. And this stress-induced resin is called the aloes. You know aloes? That was one of the perfume that was being added, or probably it was used as an embalming on Jesus' body as well. Myrrh and aloes. So this is where, you know, you and I would be, even if you are today affected in your life, if you are affected, if you are wounded spiritually, imagine there is a fragrance in store for you. There is going to be a fragrance in your life. Victory is ours by salvation. We will always be victorious in our lives. That's the promise of God. We will never be defeated. My failure in class 10th, today it turns out to be a victory. And I look back and I give thanks. Well, that's what I would like to say. We are not serving a God that is defeated. We are serving a God that is victorious. And we will always have victory. But my prayer is, dear friends, dear brothers and sisters today, listen carefully. Give time to the word of God, please, for God's sake. Many questions that you have today will all be answered. Today, if I have any issues, I go to the word of God. I say, Lord, please give me an answer. I choose any portion, and that's where God speaks to me. Dear church, this is where you and I should be. Rather than running from pillar to post, it's not going to serve any purpose. There's no point in crying. Well, cry to the Lord. That is good. But then also believe that the tears are being wiped away. He has been with us. Now remember, if you are in a situation, if you are in a storm, always remember Jesus has walked ahead of you in the storm. You will never be defeated. The storm is not going to take your life. Rather, you will learn to overcome it. I have this experience. I often share my experiences. That's the reason I shared my experiences with you. Be like the Aguilaria tree. You may be inflicted. You may be afflicted by mold, but that mold will become one day fragrant in your life. Dear church, listen carefully. I'm pleading and I'm praying every day that this church should experience the word of God. You don't need to run around to any place. You don't need to go from church to church. The word of God, that is enough. What happened to Martha and Mary? Martha was running around though Jesus was with her. But Mary sat at the feet of Jesus, listening to the word of God. That is Jesus Christ. That's where you have to be. Don't worry about anything in your life. Nobody can take your job. Don't worry about your job. It is God who has placed you there. Don't worry about your job. Don't worry if somebody is going to harm you. God has already taken it on himself on the cross. You are not going to be affected anymore. Nobody can touch you. Because the Holy Spirit is in you, God in you. Nobody can do any harm to you. This is the promise, dear church. I'm telling you, I chose this portion because I know how much important this particular word was for me. That all people were inflicted. Dear church, this is the message. Listen carefully. Please read the word of God. Get time to read. You will never get time to read the word of God because Satan will make you so busy in life. But you make it a point to read and just share the situation with the world, that is Jesus Christ, and Jesus will answer the question to you. God bless you all. Thank you. Let us affirm our faith by saying the Nicene Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of